بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يا رب العالمين. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome you all to our lesson number 4 in the book القواعد المثلى في صفات الله وأسمائه الحسنى. For our Sheikh العلامة محمد ابن صالح ابن عثيمين رحمة الله تعالى عليه. And today inshallah ta'ala we'll start with the second chapter which is related to the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal. In the previous chapter we have covered the principles pertaining the names of Allah Azza wa Jal, and there were 7 principles. And today we'll start with the principles of Allah's attributes Azza wa Jal. So the Shaykh rahimahullah ta'ala started with the first principle, Al-Qa'idatul Ula, and he said, Sifatullahi ta'ala kulluha sifatu kamalin la naqsa fiha biwajhin min al-wujuh. So the attributes of Allah Azza wa Jal are all attributes of perfection and are complete. They have no defects or flaw, none whatsoever. So this is to affirm that Allah's attributes are all perfect, all complete, and they do not imply in any way any defect or flaw to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Shaykh mentioned examples like the attribute of life, knowledge, ability, hearing, seeing, mercy, might, wisdom, His highness, and glorification, and so on. And those are attributes that belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We affirm them in a manner that befits His majesty, the exalted He is. And the Shaykh mentioned that these attributes have perfection and completeness, and the proof for that is from the Quran, Sunnah, and the intellect, and the fitrah, the innate disposition. And the Shaykh started by mentioning the proof from the as-sam'. As-sam', you may see a lot used by the Shaykh here to mean an-naql, the text, which is the Quran and the authentic Sunnah. So he started by mentioning Allah's statement subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah An-Nahl, لِلَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ مَثَلُ السَّوءِ وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. And to those who do not believe in the hereafter, the most evil description. And to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the highest attribute. So in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala affirms to Himself, the exalted He is, that He has the most high attributes that befits His majesty Azza wa Jal. So the ayah talks about al-wasf, the attribute of Allah Azza wa Jal, and it is all perfect, all complete. And of course there are many verses of the Quran which affirm this, and the authentic sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. And from the aql, the intellect, the Shaykh rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi mentioned that every existing being in real, certainly he must have attributes. And these attributes are either attributes of perfection or attributes of imperfection. And certainly the attributes of imperfection, we do not ascribe it to Allah Azza wa Jal, the exalted, the one who is the all complete, the all perfect, the one who deserves to be worshipped alone without associating any partners with him whatsoever. So this is why when it comes to speaking about existing things, they must have attributes. So it either are attributes of perfection and completeness, or the opposite. And of course, we only affirm to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the all perfect, the most high attributes to Him Azza wa Jal. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used in the Quran the example of the false deities and how they are described with imperfection, flaws and defection. That's why it was presented as an argument to the pagans of Mecca and those who chose not to believe in Allah Azza wa Jal, that how can you, logically speaking, worship and direct your acts of worship to objects which are ascribed with defects and flaws, like in the ayah the Sheikh used here. وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُو مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَهُمْ عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ. And who is more astray than the one who calls besides Allah, whom they do not respond to his call until the day of judgment, and they are unaware of their supplication. Meaning that these are inanimate piece of stones that cannot avail you in any way. And they are described with flaws and defection. So hence, how can you take them as objects of worship? And also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the other ayah, وَالَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ لَا يَخْلُقُونَ شَيْئًا وَهُمْ يُخْلَقُونَ أَمْوَاتٌ غَيْرُ أَحْيَاءٌ وَمَا يَشْعُرُونَ أَيَّانَ يُبْعَثُونَ. And those whom they invoke besides Allah Azza wa Jal, they do not create a thing while they themselves are created. أَمْوَاتٌ غَيْرُ أَحْيَاءٌ, they are dead, not alive. And they do not know when their resurrection is going to be. So again, these objects of worship that you have taken, O pagans of Mecca, as deities besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look to their attributes, look to their description, how full they are, how full of defect they are, how inanimate they are, yet you are taking them as object of worship besides Allah Azza wa Jal. And he also mentioned the ayah when Ibrahim alayhi salam presented an argument to his father, trying to trigger his intellect to re-evaluate what he is worshipping. So Ibrahim said to his father, Ya abati lima ta'budu ma la yasma'u wa la yubsiru wa la yughni anka shay'a. Oh my father, why do you worship that which does not hear, nor does it see, and it does not avail you in any way? So, if this is the case, that this object of worship is full with defection and flaws, and it is actually a piece of stone, how can you take it as an object of worship? And this is to affirm to his father that the one who is more perfect, more complete with his attribute, he is the one who should be worthy of worship, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So such verses were used and presented to trigger the pagans to reflect upon what they are worshipping. And if they are full with flaws and defects, how can they be taken as objects of worship? Also, the Shaykh used the other ayah in Surah Al-Anbiya, أَفَتَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ مَا لَيَنْفَعُكُمْ شَيْئًا وَلَا يَضُرُّكُمْ أُفٍّ لَكُمْ وَلِمَا تَعْبُدُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Do you worship besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that which does not profit you in a way, and it does not even harm you? أُفٍّ لَكُمْ, meaning how a form or a statement to show disgust from what they are doing. Of that which you have worshipped besides Allah, don't you use reason to evaluate what exactly you're doing and what is the thing that you are worshipping? Is it worth worshipping or not? That object which is inanimate, does not move, does not react, does not do anything at all to you or for you, how can you take it as an object of worship? Meaning that the one who is with all the complete attributes, with all perfect attributes, he is the one who is worthy of worship, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also logically, the Sheikh is saying that we have, it has been proven through senses and observation that this created being has attributes of perfection which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to. Hence, the one who gives these perfect attributes to those beings, he is the one who owns and has the attributes of perfection and completeness, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the one who gave those people or brought those people to existence, and we see them having attributes of perfection. Hence, he, subhanahu wa ta'ala, must be with more perfect and most perfect and complete attributes, azza wa jalla. So this is the proofs from the intellect, using intellectual argument or rational argument to present to those who may think that there are, if we affirm these attributes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be an attributes of imperfection. And we say to them, no, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned explicitly that he is with full and complete and all perfect attributes, and he subhanahu wa ta'ala in fact questioned and argued with the pagans of Mecca and the pagans in general, talking to their intellect, how would you take object of worship which do not possess attributes of perfection and completeness? And from the fitra, the innate or the natural instinct, the Sheikh mentioned that people in nature, they are they are created with the feelings, the inner feeling that they love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they glorify Him, they worship Him, the exalted He is. And certainly they would not glorify and worship and show that reverence unless this worshipped deity is with all complete and all perfect attributes, subhanahu wa ta'ala, the attributes of rububiyyah and uluhiyyah that he possesses, the exalted he is. Since he is ascribed with the complete, the all perfect attributes, hence people, they feel the need and the urge that he should be worshipped, he should be glorified, and he is the one who should be singled out in love, in fear, and hope, and so on. So this is from the fitra, we sense that people look up to the one who possesses the all perfect, the all complete attributes. So the fitra explicitly entails that the one who is worshipped, he is certainly with the all perfect, the all complete attributes, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Sheikh goes on and mentions some of the arguments why the attributes of that may imply defect or flaw should be negated from being ascribed to Allah Azza wa Jal. So if the attribute was an attribute of imperfection or flaw, where it has no perfection in it whatsoever, then this kind of attributes we do not affirm to Allah the Exalted. And the Sheikh mentioned the attributes like death or ignorance or forgetting or inability or blindness or deafness and so on, such attributes which imply imperfection completely, such attributes, we negate them all from being ascribed to Allah the Exalted Azza wa Jal. So we need to be aware of this. And the Quran, in some cases, mention these attributes and negates these attributes from being ascribed to Allah Azza wa Jal. And the Sheikh mentioned some of the proofs from the Quran to support this. He said, وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ, and have trust upon the all-living, the one who does not die, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here he negated death from upon himself, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said also about Musa alayhi salam, فِي كِتَابٍ لَا يَضِلُّ رَبِّي وَلَا يَنْسَى, that when Musa was describing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the Pharaoh, he said, Allah, he said, this is written in a book in which Allah does not err and does not forget. وَلَا يَنْسَى. And of course, if you see the word forget, yansa, it implies two things when it is mentioned in the Quran. It's either mentions or it is defined by forgetting, that the mind does not remember an issue or a thing. And also it is used to mean at-tark. At-tark ma' al-amd wal-ilm, to abstain or refrain from doing something while knowing, and you refrain from doing it intentionally. So to refrain from something intentionally while knowing, this is also called in the Arabic language as nisyan. So in this ayah, في كتاب لا يضل ربي ولا ينسى, Allah is negating from upon himself to have an attribute of forgetting. Allah does not forget the exalted he is. But we do see in other verses like نسوا الله فنسيهم, they forgot Allah and he has forgotten them. Does that imply in any way that Allah forgets? This ayah here, the word nasiya, to be translated as that they forget and he forgets, of course, this is not correct. But rather, that they intentionally, with knowledge, had forsaken or abstained from responding to the call of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, Allah azza wa jal had abstained intentionally with knowledge from looking to them and helping them. So the ayah here, an-nisyan, nasu allaha fanasiyahum, they have abstained from complying with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guidance. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abstained from helping them and giving them extra support. Also, when Allah spoke about Adam alayhi salam, and he said, وَلَقَدْ عَهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ آدَمَ مِنْ قَبْلُ فَنَسِي وَلَمْ نَجِدْ لَهُ عَزْمًا, and we have given to Adam alayhi salam before, meaning that to abstain from the eating from the trees, specific trees in al-Jannah. And Adam فَنَسِيَ, Adam here, the word نَسِيَ, certainly Adam did not forget that Allah had forbidden him from eating from that tree, but he ate from it while knowing and deliberately, but he was deceived by the shaitan who made him eat from that tree. So Adam, what he did here, he did not eat from the tree because he forgot that it is haram upon him to eat from the tree, but rather he was deceived by the shaitan and he deliberately deliberately did what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him not to do. And then Adam repented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah accepted his repentance. So be aware of this, ya ikhwa. And also he mentioned the ayah وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعْجِزَهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. And nothing would have make Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unable to do, whether it was in the heavens or the earth. So Allah is negating the inability from upon himself Azza wa Jal. And also he mentioned a hadith from the Sunnah that Ad-Dajjal, the pseudo-Christ, he said, إِنَّهُ أَعْوَرْ وَإِنَّ رَبَّكُمْ لَيْسَ بِأَعْوَرْ. That the Dajjal, the pseudo-Christ, is going to be one-eyed, while your Rabb is not one-eyed. This is to affirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has two eyes, the exalted He is, in a manner that befits His majesty. And also he mentioned the hadith, of course the hadith of Dajjal is in Bukhari and Muslim. And also he mentioned another hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, when he said, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسِ إِرْبَعُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ فَإِنَّكُمْ لَا تَدْعُونَ أَصَمَّ وَلَا غَائِبًا. O people, take it easy upon yourself. You are not calling or supplicating to a one who is deaf or absent. So Allah is negating, or the Prophet peace be upon him, is negating such a description from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah is not deaf, is not absent, meaning that He is the all-hearing. He is all aware of what they are saying and doing. And the Sheikh mentioned also that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had dispraised those who attributes to Him any defects or flaw, or any attributes of defect or flaw. When he said about the Jews, when they said, وَقَالَتِ الْيَهُودُ يَدُ اللَّهِ مَغْلُولَةٌ غُلَّتْ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَلُعِنُوا بِمَا قَالُوا بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ يُنْفِقُ كَيْفَ يَشَاءُ. When the Jews said about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that His hands are tied up, Allah said to them, may your hands be tied up and cursed for what they have said. Fairly His hands are extended in spending however He wills, the exalted He is. So when the Jews ascribe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this negative attribute, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala negated such description from being ascribed to Him, and He had dispraised and cursed those who had ascribed such defect to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala azza wa jal. Also when they said themselves, the Jews, لَقَدْ سَمِعَ اللَّهُ قَوْلَ الَّذِينَ قَالُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ فَقِيرٌ وَنَحْنُ أَغْنِيَاءُ سَنَكْتُبُ مَا قَالُوا وَقَتْلَهُمُ الْأَنْبِيَاءَ بِغَيْرِ حَقٍّ وَنَقُولُ ذُوقُوا عَذَابَ الْحَرِيقِ. And he said, Allah heard the statement of those who said that Allah is poor and we are rich. We shall write what they have said, and their killing of the prophets without due right, and we say, taste the punishment of the hellfire. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here dispraised and promised to punish those who ascribe to Him any flaws or defects, the exalted He is, like the Jews did here. Also Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had free Himself from having any flaws or defects or imperfection, the exalted He is. So He said, Subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun wa salamun al mursaleen walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. So all praise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Rabb of might, the Lord of might, of what they ascribe to Him Azza wa Jal. So he has nazzaha nafsahu, he had praised himself from being ascribed to Him any flaws or defects or imperfection Azza wa Jal. And he instead affirmed the all perfect, the all complete attributes to Himself, the exalted. And like we have mentioned, remember in the first principle related to Allah's names, that Asma'ullah Ta'ala Husna, that Allah's names are all perfect. We have mentioned there that there are some attributes in which may imply some imperfection in some context and may imply perfection in another. So here, how we go about dealing with such attributes. So like, remember we took the ayat, وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. Here, the makr to plot, and they plot, and Allah plots, and Allah the best of who plot, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So using the word plot alone, here it implies imperfection. But when it is used against someone who is plotting against you, here it becomes an attribute of perfection. So that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He mentions such attribute, it is not attributed to Allah Azza wa Jal without being used against those who are using it against Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, or against His deen or His prophets. So we make sure that when we talk about such attribute, we only ascribe it to Allah Azza wa Jal in a manner where it is against those who are plotting against Allah Azza wa Jal or His deen in general. Also, إِنَّهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا وَأَكِيدُ كَيْدًا فَمَهِّلِ الْكَافِرِينَ أَمْهِلْهُمْ رُوَيْدًا. Here, this attribute on its own, it implies perfection and imperfection. From one way, there is perfection. From another, there is imperfection. So, how do we go about dealing with such attributes? We say again, we only affirm it to Allah Azza wa Jal in a manner which completely implies perfection, where there is an estimation or a probability of imperfection at all. So when we say that they plan and Allah plans, here it is something against something. So when they plan, Allah plans against their plan. We only say Allah plan whomever against whomever plans against Him. Allah plots against whomever plots against Him or against His religion. But we do not say or give a name out of that attribute to Allah Azza wa Jal by saying Allah is the planner or the plotter, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we cannot ascribe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the attribute by saying Allah plots, that's it, and plans, that's it. No, it must be plots against whomever plots against Him, plans against whomever plans against Him. So it must be in this context in order to imply perfection to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, the issue of khida', to deceive. Allah said subhanahu wa ta'ala about the munafiqin, the hypocrites, إِنَّ الْمُنَافِقِينَ يُخَادِعُونَ اللَّهَ وَهُوَ خَادِعُهُمْ. The hypocrites are deceiving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah is deceiving them. So again, we cannot ascribe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the attribute of deception alone. No, the right way to deal with such attribute is to say Allah deceives whomever tries to deceive Him, Azza wa Jal. But do not say Allah deceives and you stop there. And you do not say Allah is a deceiver. You make a name out of that attribute. No. Why? Because this attribute alone, it may imply perfection, and similarly also it may imply imperfection. It depends upon the context in which it was used in. And we do see also, like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned about the Jews when they have plot and planned to kill Isa alayhi salam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had put their plot into failure subhanahu wa ta'ala, and saved Isa alayhi salam from their plot and plan, and made them kill the one who had tried to report Isa alayhi salam to the Romans in order to execute him. So they plot, and Allah plotted Azza wa Jal, and Allah's plot was the overcome their plot in this case. Also, we have the issue of mocking, istihza. This is a sifa mentioned in the Quran. It was ascribed to Allah Azza wa Jal, but it was not ascribed to Allah Azza wa Jal as is alone. No, it was ascribed to Allah Azza wa Jal in a context where the kuffar was trying to mock Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah mocked against him. Allah said, "Qalu," like in Surah Al-Baqarah, "Qalu inna ma'akum innama nahnu mustahzi'un." Allahu yastahzi'u bihim. They said, "We are only with you," meaning those al-munafiqin. They say, "We are with you, O kuffar. We are only mocking what the Muslims are upon." But Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah mocks them, the exalted. Again here, look how this attribute was used in a context to imply that it was used against those who were trying to mock Allah Azza wa Jal in this case. So again, such attributes, the plotting, the planning, the deception, the mocking, it is used in a specific context. We only use the context which implies complete perfection and avoid the context which may imply any imperfection to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. We do see another attribute used in the Quran, but it was not ascribed to Allah Azza wa Jal. We have al-khiyana. The khiyana is betrayal. If someone betrays someone, they say betrayal in its nature, it is all imperfect from all means. There is no way in the Arabic language, practically speaking, that this behavior may imply any perfection at all. So al-khiyana, betrayal, is imperfect completely. So this is why we have the ayah, وَإِن يُرِيدُ خِيَانَتَكْ فَقَدْ خَانُوا اللَّهَ مِنْ قَبْلِ فَأَمْكَنَ مِنْهُمْ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. And if they want to betray you, they have betrayed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before. فَأَمْكَنَ مِنْهُمْ. Allah empowered you over them. And Allah is the all-knowing, the all-wise, the exalted He is. Notice here, Allah did not say Allah betrayed them, like He said in the case of وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهِ. They plot and Allah plots. إِنْهُمْ يَكِيدُونَ كَيْدًا وَأَكِيدُ كَيْدًا. They plot and Allah plots, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But here in the case of betray, it was never used in the Quran in a context that Allah betrays whomever tries to betray Him. So the khiyana, it is negated completely, because from all aspects it only implies imperfection, and there is no way for perfection to be derived from such attribute. So this is the first attribute, the first principle the Sheikh mentioned here, which is that Allah's attributes are all complete and all perfect. They do not imply any imperfection or any defect, none whatsoever. And the second attribute, he said, بَابُ الصِّفَاتِ أَوْسَعُ مِنْ بَابِ الْأَسْمَاءِ. He said, the attributes are broader than the names, meaning in number. Like we said earlier, that every, in the second principle of names, every name has an attribute. Every name must have an attribute. We said that Allah's names are titles and descriptions. So every name must have an attribute, but not every attribute has a name. So this is why the attributes are greater in number than the names. So this qaida, بَابُ الصِّفَاتِ أَوْسَعُ مِنْ بَابِ الْأَسْمَاءِ. The topic of names, or the topic of attributes, is broader or greater in number than the topic of Allah's names, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason for that, like I said, because every name has an attribute, But not every attribute has a name. And like we all know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributes has and his actions have no limit, the exalted he is. And like we have mentioned earlier, and the Sheikh used here as a proof the ayah of Surah Luqman, وَلَوْ أَنَّمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٌ وَالْبَحْرُ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ. If what's on earth of trees, if all the trees on earth were pens, and the sea is supplied with seven seas, meaning, and the sea was an ink to write with these pens, and the sea was supplied with seven seas, the sea would run out of water, while Allah will not run out of a speech and statement, subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how immense Allah's statement is, and that it has no limit. So Allah does whatever He wills, whenever He wills, the exalted He is, and there is no limit to His actions, the exalted He is. Allah said, فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدُ. There was never a time in the past where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was idle from doing anything. He was always attributed with action, does whatever He wills. فَعَالٌ لِمَا يُرِيدُ, like He said subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then the Sheikh mentioned some of the attributes as an example here to show that we have attributes that have no names. And he mentioned Al-Maji. Al-Maji, it's coming from the verb Ja'a. Wal-Ityan, it's taken from the verb Ata, also coming or come. Wal-Akhd, to seize. Wal-Imsak, to withhold. Wal-Batsh, to strike. And the other many attributes mentioned in the Quran and the authentic Sunnah. And the Sheikh mentions the proofs for those attributes that he had mentioned and listed here. The first is وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ, and Allah came, meaning Allah will come يوم القيامة. Notice the in Arabic, in the Quran, it is mentioned in the past form. The verbs are mentioned in the past form. This is to imply that it will certainly take place. So it is used in the Arabic context by expressing a statement in the past tense, meaning that it will certainly happen later in the future. So the Quran is full with such types of statements which imply that an issue will take place in the future. So وَجَاءَ رَبُّكَ, meaning Allah will come يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. And this is a statement which affirm that Allah will come. How does Allah come, subhanahu wa ta'ala? We do not know. Again, we negate knowing the how-to of His actions. But we understand what the coming means. So we affirm it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that befits His majesty, azza wa jal. Also, he mentioned the proof for the second attribute he mentioned, al-ityan, to come also. وَهَلْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَأْتِيَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي ظُلَلٍ مِّنَ الْغَمَمِ. Do they await but for Allah to come with clouds, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here, the ayah speaks that Allah will come يوم القيامة, the exalted He is. So we affirm it to Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also the ayah, فَأَخَذَهُمُ اللَّهُ بِذُنُوبِهِمْ. Allah sees them by their sins. So here, the seizing is also an attribute for Allah Azza wa Jal, which is an attribute of action, of course. All those attributes mentioned here are attributes of action. Also the ayah, الْإِمْسَاكُ, withhold. وَيُمْسِكُ السَّمَاءَ أَن تَقَعَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ إِلَّا بِإِذْنِهِ. And He holds, or He withholds the heavens from falling down upon the earth unless by His permission. So again, this ayah speaks that Allah withholds the heavens from falling upon the earth. So again, we affirm such attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that befits His majesty. Also, al-batsh, to strike. Inna batsha rabbika la shadid. Fairly, Allah's strike is severe. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah yabtushu, or yabtishu subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we affirm this attribute of action again. Also, the irada, the intention, the will. يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرَ وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرَ. Allah wants to ease things upon you. He does not want to make it harsh or hard upon you. Also, he mentioned the hadith, يَنْزِلُ رَبُّنَا إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا, the hadith of Abi Huraira in Bukhari Muslim, that Allah descends to the worldly heavens. So the descending of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, again, we affirm that Allah descends on the last third portion of the night in a manner that befits His Majesty Azza wa Jal. So all those attributes are proven in the Quran and the authentic Sunnah. So we affirm it to Allah Azza wa Jal, or we affirm them to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Azza wa Jal in a manner that befits His Majesty. And we cannot derive names to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from these attributes. Why can't we derive names? Because it was not, Allah was not named in the Quran nor in the authentic Sunnah with such names, like we have taken in the previous chapter. Amongst the principles of Allah's names, that it is tawqifiyya, that it is limited to what is mentioned in the Quran and the authentic Sunnah. We cannot make up names for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even from attributes which are ascribed to Him Azza wa Jal. So these are attributes, again, the Shaykh mentioned them and listed them here to prove to us that there are attributes which have no name, to give us an indicator that the attributes are more than the names of Allah Azza wa Jal. So we do not call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-ja'i, the comer, or the one who seizes, or the withholder, or the striker, or the wanter, for instance, or the descender. We cannot make up names from these attributes, again, because we are limited to the Quran and Sunnah when naming Allah Azza wa Jal. We cannot, although we may have attributes ascribed to Him, we cannot use these attributes to derive out of them names for Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Shaykh used such attributes as a proof here. Let us move to the third principle. And the Shaykh said, rahimahullah ta'ala, صِفَاتُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى تَنْقَسِمُ إِلَى قِسْمَيْنِ ثُبُوتِيَّةِ وَسَلْبِيَّةِ. So the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are of two types. We have attributes of affirmation, affirmative attributes, and attributes of negation. So attributes of affirmation and attributes of negation. And the Shaykh started talking about the attributes of affirmation. And the attributes of affirmation are the attributes which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had affirmed to Himself Azza wa Jal, either in His book or upon the tongue of His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And certainly these attributes are all attributes of perfection, which does not imply in any way any flaw or defect, none whatsoever. And the Shaykh mentioned again some examples of these affirmed attributes. He said, like al-hayat, life, knowledge, ability, al-istiwa al-arsh, rising above the throne, al-nuzul ila al-sama' al-dunya, to descend to the worldly heavens, the face, the two hands. So those are all attributes which are affirmed in the Quran or in the authentic Sunnah. So those attributes of affirmation. How do we deal with these attributes? We affirm them all in a manner that befits His Majesty. What is the proof for such attributes of affirmation? We have from as-sam', meaning the text, the Quran and Sunnah, and we have from the al-aql, the intellect. So the Shaykh started mentioning from the Quran the proof that support that Allah has affirmed attributes to himself Azza wa Jal. And he used the ayah in Surah An-Nisa, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا آمِنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَالْكِتَابِ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ عَلَى رَسُولِهِ وَالْكِتَابِ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ مِن قَبْلُ وَمَن يَكْفُرْ بِاللَّهِ وَمَلَائِكَتِهِ وَكُتُبِهِ وَرُسُلِهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا. He said, O you who believe in Allah and His Messenger and His book which He had revealed upon His Prophet, and the book which He has revealed before, and whomever disbelieves in Allah and His Messenger, His angels, His books and His messengers, and the hereafter, certainly had gone stray greatly. So how do we take from such ayah a proof that he had affirmed attributes to himself? He said the belief in what was stated in this ayah, to believe in Allah and His Messenger and His book, this explicitly implies that we believe everything said by him and everything said by his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and everything stated in the Quran. If this is the case, whatever is stated in the Quran and in the authentic Sunnah and said by Allah Azza wa Jal, we accept and take completely. And among the issues that was mentioned in the Quran and the authentic Sunnah and said by Allah Azza wa Jal is affirming to himself the attributes of perfection and completeness. So this is the proof from the Quran. Of course, the Sheikh used just this one proof, and the Quran and Sunnah are full, of course, with proofs. The second set of proofs is al-aql, the intellect. How the intellect also affirms to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributes. He said, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us about himself, and he is more knowledgeable about himself than anyone else, and certainly he is the all truthful, the exalted he is, then whatever he had said to us and affirmed to us, we should take and accept, because he is the all truthful subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is logically speaking, this is how we may prove that Allah Azza wa Jal has affirmed to himself attributes, because he is the all-knowing and he knows about himself more than anyone else, and he is the truthful. So hence, whatever he tells us, we accept and take and believe in. Similarly, the case with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whenever he tells us anything about Allah Azza wa Jal, for the Prophet, peace be upon him, he is the most person who knows Allah Azza wa Jal than anyone else, and he is also the truthful, as-sadiq, al-ameen, the trustworthy, and he is more eager to save his followers and to guide them to the best way in which they can worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that befits him subhanahu wa ta'ala. So hence, whatever he says to us, we accept and take and believe in. In fact, we must take and accept and believe in, because he is the messenger of Allah Azza wa Jalla. So this is the affirmative attributes which we affirm to Allah Azza wa Jalla. And then he talks about الصفات السلبية, the attributes of negation. So we have in the Quran verses where Allah negates some attributes from being ascribed to him Azza wa Jal. And whatever he negates subhanahu wa ta'ala, we accept and believe, because it's all attributes of defect and flow, like the case of death, sleep, ignorance, forgetting, inability, fatigue, and so on. Those are attributes which were negated in the Quran from being ascribed to Allah Azza wa Jal. So such attributes, because they are negative, they are full with flaw and defect, they do not imply any perfection at all to the Creator. That's why they must be negated from being ascribed to Him Azza wa Jal. And of course, when these attributes are negated in the Quran or in the authentic Sunnah, the reason behind doing that is to try to affirm the opposite, to affirm the completeness of the opposite. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala negates death from being ascribed to Him, why is He negating? To affirm to us the completeness of the opposite of death, which is life. That He is the all-living subhanahu wa ta'ala, the alive Azza wa Jal, who does not die. He was not preceded by Adam, void, and He will not be succeeded by death, the exalted He is. So His, when we negate death from being ascribed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are here affirming the opposite to Him, the exalted. Similarly, the case with the noom, sleep. لا تأخذه سينة ولا نوم. When we negate sleep or slumber from being ascribed to Him Azza wa Jal, this is to affirm His complete qayyumiyya and hayat and life, that He is the all living. He does not sleep, He does not die subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not slumber at all. So when we negate, we are affirming the completeness of the opposite attribute. Similarly, the case with al-jahl, ignorant, we are affirming when we negate here that He is the all-knowing. Similarly, the case with the nisyan, forgetting, we are affirming that Allah لا يضل ربي ولا ينسى, that He does not forget, the exalted He is, the inability, He does not, is not inable at all, He is the all-able. In fact, we affirm the completeness of the opposite. Because the negation itself, the negation in its own, it's not perfection unless it comprises with perfect meaning. So when you negate, in general, when you negate, while not implying affirming the opposite, negation on its own does not imply perfection. How is that? For instance, when you say the wall does not do injustice, you are negating injustice from being practiced by a wall, right? So in nature, the wall is inanimate. It's a non-living thing. It cannot do anything in the first place. So that's why when you negate here, you are not affirming anything good or any completeness to the wall here. So this is why when we just negate, we need to attend in our mind that we are affirming the completeness of the opposite, in order for the negation that we see in the Quran and the authentic Sunnah to be most fitting to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is the reason behind having the negation in the Quran, like we're going to mention in the coming principle. So the negation itself, it may not imply perfection unless we affirm the opposite. Also, secondly, when we negate something upon, when we negate an attribute upon something or from something, it could be that this thing in which we are negating this flaw or defect attribute is not applicable to hold that attribute. Like the example I mentioned to you of the wall. And someone says, the wall does not do any injustice. Here, the wall does not do any injustice because the wall is not applicable to do injustice in the first place. Why? Because it's a non-living thing. It cannot do anything. So when we negate such an issue, such an attribute from the wall, we are not implying any perfection to it. And the Sheikh mentioned here some poems or lines of poem said by some poets to support this concept. And he mentioned the line of poem, قُبَيِّلَةٌ لَا يَغْدُرُونَ بِذِمَّةٍ وَلَا يَظْلِمُونَ النَّاسَ حَبَّةَ خَرْدَلِ. He said, someone describing his tribe. The line of poem itself, apparently it implies that he is praising them. But in real, he was dispraising them. He said, my tribe, or a tribe, in fact, he used a form to name his tribe, which implies that they are small in their value, in their level, and so on, and rank. They do not deceive anyone, and they do not do any injustice, not even the size of the mustard seed. So it appears that he is praising them, but in reality he was dispraising them by saying that because they are so weak, they are not able to deceive. Because they are so weak, they cannot do any injustice. So they in nature are not applicable to do such things. So to negate such negative attributes does not make them good, does not make them perfect, because in nature, in the first place, they are so weak, they cannot even practice any injustice or do any deception to anyone. Also use the another line of poem to give the same meaning. لكن قومي وإن كانوا ذوي حسب ليسوا من الشر في شيء وإن هانا. He said, my people, my tribe, although they may be of a good rank, they have good lineage, but they are not people who do any level of evil at all. So he negated them from practicing any evil at all. And the motive behind him saying this is to dispraise his people because they are so weak. To an extent, they cannot practice any evil upon anyone. So notice here, negating the evil attribute not necessarily imply perfection. It may just be said to imply that they are weak. They are not applicable to do that evil thing in the first place. So negation alone in itself, it does not imply perfection, unless we use it to affirm the completeness of the opposite. Here it becomes a statement of perfection in this case. And the Sheikh mentioned the ayat to support that. وَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى الْحَيِّ الَّذِي لَا يَمُوتُ. So Allah says subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, and have trust upon the all-living, the one who does not die, Azza wa Jal. So he had negated from upon himself, Azza wa Jal, death. When he negated death, he mentioned earlier in the same ayah, the all-living. So here, a negation which implies the completeness of the opposite, which is that he is the all-living. He does not die at all, Azza wa Jal. So again, when he negated here, he wanted to affirm the completeness of the opposite. Also, وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. Allah does not do any injustice upon anyone. So here he had negated practicing any injustice upon anyone. What does that imply? It implies that we are affirming to him the completeness of the opposite in this case, that he is the all-just subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third example the Sheikh used here, the ayah in Fatir, وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُعْجِزَهُ مِنْ شَيْءٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. And nothing upon Allah is unable to do in the heavens nor on earth. So Allah is the all-able. He has negated inability from being ascribed to him, and he had affirmed to him, Azza wa Jal, that he is the all able. And he said at the end of the ayah, إِنَّهُ كَانَ عَلِيمًا قَدِيرًا. when he negated the inability, he affirmed at the end of the ayah, verily he is the all-knowing, the all-able. So inability, it may be because of, like the Sheikh here said, ignorance or lack of ability. So to affirm that, or when he negated the inability from upon himself, he had affirmed the opposite. He had affirmed the ability and he had affirmed knowledge, meaning that he is able while maintaining knowledge, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So negated inability, which here implies the affirmation of the completeness of the opposite, which is ability with knowledge. So again, from this principle, we may understand that the attributes of negation may imply more than one attribute of perfection. Like in the case of the last example, when Allah negated al-ajz, inability, He had affirmed two attributes here. He affirmed His ability and His knowledge, the exalted He is. So the attributes of negation, they may affirm more than one attribute. Okay, I guess we'll stop here. Barakallahu feekum wa jazakumullahu khayra wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.